So the last topic is metaprogramming. What is the idea here is that we try to write programming code that creates code in a programming language. So basically you create code that then is a template for creating additional code. So what do we have in terms of concepts? Well, in C and C++, we could use preprocessor directives that create certain code. In C++, we also had templates. And then we have template metaprogramming in C++, meaning that you can use templates to create additional templates. That's why it's called metaprogramming. It creates programming on a next level. Now with C++ 11, you can compute constants at compile time using const expressions, which is a new type. So in C++, all these techniques are compile time operations. It means all the calculations performed are happening during compile time. That means they don't need to be performed when the program is running. That allows for incredible powerful tools. The problem is that it's sometimes rather difficult to understand and debug. Let's have a look at all those different levels, starting from our preprocessor directives. Little recap. So precompiler applies preprocessor macros and directives at compile time. In particular, before the actual compiler, language compiler runs the code. It's a kind of a precompiler. It works purely at text level. That means you cannot do advanced copy and, well, it can do advanced copy and paste, but it cannot do more than that. It's very basic for metaprogramming. Here we see an example. We say define sol underscore planets. So this string token is now really defined as brackets 7 + 1 brackets. Yeah, so it's not calculated to 8 or anything. It's just 7 + 1. Next, we can declare also a macro. We can say a preprocessor macro, SQR takes one argument, x. And what we write instead of x is we write brackets x times bracket x. And then we can use this as we use it anywhere in our code. I can use SQR in bracket 5. And the preprocessor will now replace this literally with brackets 5, brackets times, brackets 5, brackets, brackets. So this already shows a little bit the danger of it, because let me show you an example. What will happen if I would define SQR x just as x times x, right? You could think that's right, that makes sense. How about I would then try to print something like SQR of 5 + 2, yeah? Well, the compiler, the precompiler, will replace this literally, like we said, with this. So what's written is, in fact, here this goes away and is replaced with x times x, which means in this case 5 + 2 times 5 + 2. And well, this will be 10 + 2 + 5, so it will be 17. And not what you expect. 5 + 2, which is 7, times 7. So that's why we had to add in brackets the definitions in this way, because that will ensure that it's kind of working properly, right? Because I will get something like this. And then, of course, the compiler has to use precedence, so it will be 7 times 7. And then this will be 49, and this brackets gets basically evaluated. Yeah, so this is dangerous. Sometimes it can have a lot of mistakes. Yeah. But it has also, it's really powerful. I use it a lot. So you can use this feature also to get enums to string representation. We know that enumerations, they are only for programmatic use, so, and represented by integers. How can you convert them to a string? So you want to print them. Yeah, you do this by keeping a string array with the values. In C, for example, C++ works the same. Yeah, so I can create my enum, I can say color red, color blue, and then I create another array of strings in C++ here. And in the first element I put red, because color red represents red. Color blue is blue, and so on. And how do they work? Because the indexes or indices in both arrays, they are basically synchronized. This is actually a bit cumbersome for maintenance, and it's error prone for you. Yeah, therefore, the idea is now that we use our preprocessor to create an Enoch string mapping. So what we do, we use define to define to specify the list of items with the preprocessor define with an argument called type. So here we say define items is type computers, type scientists, type routers, type monitors. Yeah, backslash here is needed because only that way the preprocessor knows that all those commands are, but still belong to the preprocessor over here. This our directive items. Yeah, so this kind of says all those lines belong together. They form one definition. Now, let's have a look how we can then use it. So we define type E first as an E. This specifies that the type as a preprocessor will be replaced by removing this type. So let's see. So when we define type E with E, then we define our class, enum class items, with items. And well, what will this do? Well, it will place here this token, finds the token items, trying to replacing type. Type just goes away because that's what we define type E as a macro is just E. Basically, we put computers, scientists, routers, and monitors here as a text. Afterwards, we remove our definition of the macro type again. Then we define type as a string. That's why we use the hash here that asks the compiler to turn the next token into a string. Now we create our item strings, and we in brackets we just put items again, and then we undef type. So now type here in this call here will be replaced with string. So we will get the string of computers, the string of scientists, the string of routers, the string of monitors. And then afterwards we can use it by for output just saying item string in the position integer by converting our routers enum into an integer. Yeah, you can add more syntactic sugar to make this an even nicer. What we see is basically clever usage of macros, and as you can see, a macro here our directive items calls additional macros, and we define them on the fly and undefine them. Now, template metaprogramming, we already used templates in C++. The idea is, and the fun stuff is, that C++ templates are Turing complete. That means you can basically compute everything at compile time. That requires you that the operations have a static output that can be computed at compile time. And you can have any complicated program that compiles very long, but then makes a very complicated computation and gives you the result at the end. Here you see some examples. I'm not going there, but I just wanted to show you for a very simple example, which is our greatest common divisor, how we can create a template for template metaprogramming. And you'll find that this is not totally trivial. So imagine you have a function GCD and you want to input two numbers, of course, because that's how GCD is defined, like 25 and 50. And now you want to get the greatest common divisor. For this case, it's 25. When you have an input 12 and 64, the greatest common divisor is 4. And well, for 18 and a very large number, it's 6, for example. So now what we do is we create GCD, and GCD here is a template that takes two arguments, which are our numbers that we try to compute. So we try, instead of normal formal arguments, these become now template arguments. You see 25 and 50 here. And then to actually do something with them from this template, we have to access a member here of this new template that we generate, which we call result. So let's have a look what this does. So this template GCD takes two arguments, A and B, as integer. As you can see, we can actually work with integers, not only with type names, classes on other types, we can use actually values, which we didn't do before. Now here we create the only this as a structure, which means it's publicly available. all the members, we create a result as a static value. And the result of two numbers, A and B, we know this when we implement a GCD, is that you swap B and then you divide A with the remainder of and A divided by B, and the remainder is basically the second call. So this is a recursive call of GCD. And what we need to do as a result is we have to call this other smaller values, basically the result, which then calls the other template with those lower numbers. And so this goes on and on. Of course, we need to have a terminating condition. That happens when the second value is zero. Then we know the result is just A. The greatest common divisor of any number in zero is A. So now this will basically stop. And at compile time, it will create instantiate all those GCD structures and results. And you will get this result. So with C++11, there comes a new concept, which was called const expression. It's, I think, a more generalized concept of before. The idea is that you can tell a compiler that the return value of a function is constant at compile time. That allows you to create functions and expressions that are computed at compile time, and you can use this anywhere where a constant is expected. Yeah? So I can say const expression in var x is 10. That's pretty much the same as saying const int var x is 10. But additionally, what you can do, you can have a function get 5. This one returns a const expression, which consists of var x divided by 2. Yeah, we know this value here is a constant expression, so known at compile time. So will be the result of get 5. So what you can do, you can, in this case, we just call this function get 5 plus 7, which will, well, lead to a creation of an array of 12 integers. But this call get 5 is evaluated at compile time. Sometimes that's really neat because it speeds up the execution, but in the same time, it allows you to keep your code easier to maintain because this function get 5 might be easier to read than just putting 5 here in this example. To wrap up today's talk, we can perform object-oriented programming in C. In fact, it's a bit tedious without the syntactic sugar of C++, but it's absolutely possible, and a lot of implementations use at least parts of the concept that you learned today. Really, I think this is really amazing and shows you how potent the C programming language in fact is. Secondly, we looked at modern C++, which was mainly we looked at C++11, which was a big step forward for C++. We looked at lambda expressions that allow you to define functions in Lime, the enum classes, which avoid to pollute the global namespace, and we used threading a little bit to allow concurrently usage of multiple processors, multiple cores that you have in your machine. Lastly, we looked a bit more at metaprogramming that allows you to more optimize code, meaning it allows you at compile time to compute certain results to then lead to better optimized code. And that was pretty much the last lecture that you have as part of this course. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. And I wish you all the very best for your future.